Okay, good evening, welcome. So it gives me great pleasure to start off our talk on the intersection between language and social justice by introducing our first speaker, Cece Cutler. She's a full professor at Lehman College and also an affiliated professor at the CUNY Graduate Center in both the linguistics and the LILAC departments. That's Latino, American, Iberian, and Latino culture department. And she's also in the New York, undertaking the New York City English research project now. So without any further ado, I'm going to pass it over.
Thank you so much. Thanks so much for coming and for inviting me to New School. It's really nice to be here. So I'm going to tell you a little bit today, a little bit about some research I've been working on for the past couple of years. And this has to do with some young Mexican-American rappers located mainly in Los Angeles, but also in Chicago. This particular the guy I'll be talking about today is named Jae-P, and he was born in South Central Los Angeles. His real name is Juan Pablo Huerta. And I'm interested in the kind of countercultural and counter-hegemonic discourses that he's addressing in his raps. But also in particular, I'm looking at the comment space within YouTube as a space where young people are not only expressing their views and expressing their interest and their love for rap, but also engaging directly with discourses about immigration in this country right now. So that's of particular interest given the populist direction that our politics are taking these days. This piece of research is coming out in co-edited volume. I'm working on Matt Garley sitting in the back has a chapter in that book. It's entitled Multilingual Youth Practices in Computer-Mediated Communication, and it's coming out on Cambridge in the fall. So the title of my talk today is perhaps somewhat transparent to people that know some Spanish, pinches gringos. It sounds a bit like Spanish, but when you look at it a little bit carefully, it seems to have an English ring to it. So I'm very interested in this kind of creative orthography, these sort of counter-hegemonic forms of writing, polyvocal, heteroglossic forms of writing that tell us something about the stance that young people are taking towards the hegemonic status of English in our society, but also addressing a whole range of discourses about what it means to be Mexican-American. So my point of departure here is really from critical discourse analysis and discourse analysis in general. And the main idea behind this is that the micro reflects the macro. So this is this idea is that looking at very micro interactions can give us a window into macro social and political structures. It's also a place where the powerless can contest ideologies and discourses that subjugate them and relegate them to subordinate status. The idea is that power is enacted in discourse. So linguistic interactions reflect social interaction. The study of language use is fundamental to our understanding of how oppressive social relations are created and reproduced. And powerful groups control access to public discourse and are able to control the text and context of public discourse. But it's also a place, these micro interactions are a place where we can see how the powerless resist these dominant narratives. The recent upheavals in our political system and the rise of populism and Trumpism have revived anti-immigrant and particularly anti-Mexican and anti-Islamic sentiments in US society. If you look at the news, it's really easy to identify these kind of strategies that are deployed in framing immigrants in very particular ways. You can look at things like implicature, or metaphorical and lexical strategies. Implicature being the assertion of facts that might not be true, But things like linking all Mexican immigrants to gangs or framing all Muslims as potential terrorists. People also use metaphors very effectively. Even the idea of waves of immigrants or opening the floodgates to immigration or framing immigrants as animals, as Santa Ana has looked at, are all indirect ways in which writers can get at the subconscious level and affect the thoughts and actions of people. And of course, the more obvious ones are lexical items, terms like illegal aliens that create these mental models of bodies that are deemed to be illegal or to be alien to a recipient society, leading to fear and hatred and the policing of certain bodies in different ways than others. When it comes to Latinos in our society and Spanish speakers in general, we can talk about what's called, what Carter has called the Latino threat narrative. And this is the idea that essentially that there's a set of discourses that surrounds Latinos. The idea that Latinos in our society are unwilling to learn English, that they're incapable of learning English, they're not interested in assimilating into our society, that they are planning to invade the United States and conspiring to control territories that used to be part of Mexico. So the idea behind these narratives is that the power of dominant groups is not always exercised through laws and rules, but also through norms and habits and generally accepted sets of ideas and a consensus. So these are not articulated in any kind of way, but these discourses are, we're swimming in them, and they're part of the way that we think about different groups. And so the idea is that these discourses affect the way we actually act, and whether there are actually even laws in place or not, they enact and they affect actions and they affect the way we interact with other people. So this leads me to a set of questions about this particular data set, and that is, how do first and second generation Mexican American youth resist the ways that they are conceived in these dominant narratives about immigrants? And what counter-hegemonic discursive strategies do they use to counter these kinds of narratives? And what role does social media, in particular YouTube, play in allowing ordinary people to talk back to the powerful? I'm drawing on primarily on computer-mediated discourse analysis, CMDA, by Susan Herring, and also some of the work of Yanis Andrutsopoulos. And this is the idea that sociolinguistic and discursive analytic methods can be applied to online, digital, and computer-mediated forms of language. Just a couple more things about that. CMDA applies methods adapted from language-focused disciplines such as linguistics, communication, and rhetoric to the analysis of digital data. It views online behavior through the lens of language, and its interpretations are grounded in observations about language and language use. This perspective is reflected in the application of methodological paradigms that originated in the study of spoken and written language, like conversation analysis, interactional sociolinguistics, pragmatics, text analysis, and critical discourse analysis. I'm also looking at orthography. So I'm drawing on some interesting work that's come out of linguistics, but where people are trying to understand how it is that individuals express nuance and emotion in their written forms of language. So in face-to-face communication, it's quite obvious usually what people mean. We can read their facial signals and their body language and their gestures, and we can interpret very easily what somebody means through these kinds of gestures. However, in writing, it's more difficult. So how do you indicate irony in a text message? How do you indicate that you're angry or that you're happy? You can use emoji, you can use capitalization, you can use funny spelling, there are all kinds of things. And so norms are emerging for how people are doing this in written language. And I'll talk about some examples, but one example that comes to mind very quickly is just For example, the way people use serial, what we call serial graphemes. So if you repeat the letter O many, many, many times in writing, it's not only evoking some sort of lengthened pronunciation, but oftentimes some kind of emotion that has to do with the utterance itself. So indicating that you are really, really excited, you know, really excited with lots of L's or lots of A's or lots of E's or something like that. You can also see certain graphemes, like the grapheme K in English. We call it K, right? But K has this kind of unusual significance in writing, particularly in Spanish and Romance languages like Spanish and French as well, because they don't have this grapheme. So if you choose to write a Spanish word, like let's just say a Spanish word like casa, house, and you write it with a K, it immediately assumes this kind of countercultural narrative, something that is resistant, something that contests standard norms of writing, that hints at some sort of countercultural stance. And so we can examine these cases where people make choice, they're making conscious choices. They could just as easily write a C, but they're choosing to write a K. So why is that? So these are the kinds of things one could study. I'm arguing that YouTube, and I mean, plenty of people are studying YouTube, this is nothing new, but YouTube is, you can think of it as kind of a site where you could analyze videos themselves, the content of videos. You can look at YouTube as a kind of iconic television, a screen where you can watch things and you can interact with this. It's all set up in a very kind of predictable way with little icons, and pretty soon this just becomes part of the way you see this. It's not even... it's something you even question, but you know, you have play buttons, you have, you know, volume buttons, but you also have things that tell you how many comments have been posted in response to a video. You have hands up and down. In this case, we have 16,000 people that liked this video and clicked the little hands up or thumb up button, and 760 people that didn't like it. You have the option to share it. You can cast it, you can make the video bigger, you can have closed captioning, you can do all kinds of things. So you can analyze the videos themselves, you can analyze the space that has to do with the videos, but you could also analyze the comment space. And here are just a couple of recent comments that were posted to the song that I'll be analyzing today. You can see there's a little image that people post of themselves, and you know, people choose all kinds of different images. These are some interesting choices, sometimes a face, sometimes a body part, obviously. But you know, you see basically a timestamp when the comment was posted. You see different ways that people, different choices people are making in terms of text in expressing themselves. Here, the second person is putting it in all caps. The person above is, you know, mixing kind of English and Spanish in lowercase letters. And you can have the option to reply. You can see all the people that replied to these particular comments. So I'm interested in this comment space because, you know, the video can get you so far. You can analyze a video and you can see what the content was and you can understand what the video is trying to say. But it's very interesting to see how people receive this video and the kinds of comments they're making in response to it. I'm using a couple of terms from Bakhtin, who's always, you know, a long-standing favorite. And I don't claim to be an expert about Bakhtin, and I haven't read the original. I've read people's accounts of Bakhtin, but I'm very attracted to these terms, you know, polyphony and heteroglossia. And this polyphony, this idea that a speaker's voice is always resonant within the voices of specific others, people whom the speaker listens to and whose response she or he anticipates, but also more broadly, the existence of many voices and points of view within a narrative. Now, Bakhtin was analyzing the novel as a place where you could see these, identify these different voices, but linguists have adopted this frame to understand what's going on in everyday interaction, because we are constantly revoicing and borrowing bits and pieces from narratives, from other speakers, from famous people, from commercials, from movies, and incorporating those ideas into our speech as if they were our own. In some cases, sometimes we are aligned with those voices, sometimes we're disaligning from the voices, mocking them. And then this idea of heteroglossia that emphasizes how every story is assembled from multiple codes of language, usage, and genre. In any one person's speech, multiple communities intersect, And here we get at the sociolinguistic concept of different registers, of different groups of people that have different ways of speaking that we can also index in our speech. But crucially, what's unique about heteroglossy is that oftentimes these different voices, these different speech, these different registers are in some sort of tension, some kind of conflict, or tension within a discourse. So what's interesting about Bakhtin, this is what he argues for the novel, is that just in the way that we can analyze the novel as a place where we can see these conflicts, these multiple voicings coming together and working things out, we can also analyze interaction in a similar way. We could make the case for contemporary forms of sharing like YouTube serving this kind of vital function. That is, that through heteroglossia, the authoritative, the normative, the unmarked is drawn into question, allowing what was once considered certain to be debated and open to interpretation. So the very act of counterposing, of juxtaposing different registers, the act of stylizing different voices, calls into question the entire system of the way that different registers and voices and bodies are hierarchically structured. The data I'm looking at, so it comes from this video by Jae-P, as I explained to you, was born in Los Angeles. The name of the song, title of the song, is Ni de aquí, ni de allá, which means not from here, nor from there. And this is hardly an original title. You can find it across the internet. There are books about this, there are films with the same title. I found all kinds of posters, and I'll show you a couple examples in a little while. But obviously this references a common narrative within the immigrant community, the Latino community, of feeling like one isn't really here, nor is one there. One's really not really part of the United States, not a legitimate citizen or resident of this country, but neither is one really still accepted as being a legitimate representative of Mexico or of Nicaragua or of El Salvador. So it's the nature of the second generation to feel this lack of a home, the lack of an identity. And you, if you talk to anyone who's second generation, you will get the same kinds of comments where young people are oftentimes conflicted about who they are and which identity is their real one. I looked at a sample of about 450 comments. There are now over 700 comments posted to the same song, which is not a huge number, but that's a pretty good set to look at. And I examined them superficially for language, counting language in a kind of broader sense. And most of them are in Spanish. I mean, the song itself is in Spanish. About 65% of the comments were in Spanish, 24% English, and only 9% mixed, which I thought was quite astonishing. I expected to find most of the comments containing mixed English and Spanish. Judging by about half of them were identifiable as gender female or male, and of those, most of them were male. So about half the comments had some kind of identifying marker, like a name, like Maria or Jose, and then maybe some other way, like morphological gender marking of some kind in the comment that told you a little bit about the gender identity of the speaker or of the writer. So mostly male writers, and I'm assuming most of them are young as well. It was also interesting that about 40% of the comments contained some kind of non-standard creative or digital forms of writing, which in a lot of cases, I haven't done statistics on this, but it seemed to overlap quite a bit with the kind of more strident anti-hegemonic discourse. So that was an interesting note. So let's see, just a short word about Spanish language rap in this country. So it emerged in the 1990s, at least that's when groups were actually getting some commercial recognition, with groups like Cypress Hill and Kid Frost. And then in the early 2000s, there was a big push to sign Mexican or American rappers to Univision, the television network. There were artists like Quinto Sol and Aquit and Jae-P, and they rapped in Spanish for the most part over beats infused with the sounds of older popular Mexican musical styles like banda and cumbia and norteño. The video, as I said, is entirely performed in Spanish. It's set in Southern California in a stereotypical Mexican-American neighborhood. I'll show you about a minute of the clip just so you can see a little bit about the, you know, the context. You'll hear some musical references from banda, some trumpet music, and the accordion. The themes in the video seem to center around a yearning to belong, as well as a brown pride, a kind of racial essentialization and exclusion that many young people feel. The idea that bilingualism doesn't buy acceptance, that even if you speak English, you're still not accepted as a legitimate American. And linguistic rights, the rights to use your language. We also see themes like rejection, feeling ambivalent, searching for identity. We have this deictic kind of juxtaposition of here and there, ni de aquí, ni de allá, referencing two different geological spaces, which then serve as a backdrop for us and them, and being part of the in-group, being part of the out-group, and feelings in between. And here are some examples. When you go trawling on the internet and Google images, for example, about ni de aquí, ni de allá, you'll find plenty of images in restaurants that are called ni de aquí, ni de allá, films that were made probably in the, I don't know, from the 40s or 50s, I'm not really sure. Something about being gay. We have Obama also being ni de aquí, ni de allá, as someone who's biracial. So this is a trope that gets repeated very, very frequently. The lyrics to the song then are, this is just the first verse and the chorus, and it really centers on yo no tuve opinión. I didn't have any choice in the matter. My parents brought me when I was really young to this country. My father said, let's cross the river, but not my face or my skin was the acceptable form to be made in the USA. So I wasn't worth anything. And over the years, I worked really hard, I learned English, and I thought I was really cool, and even though I spoke the language, the gringo still said I was just a wetback, a fucking joke. But I don't care what they say about me or what they think about me, my kid's going to be the president of this fucking country. The Latino of today isn't just a simple, you know, dishwasher, hey, Loretta Sanchez, who's just going to come and clean your shoes. But if you don't take advantage of this land and what it offers you, you're going to return back to presumably to Mexico like a dog that isn't grateful. You're going to go back. Mexico no te quiere. Mexico, I don't love you. And yo te quiero. I love you. And there I'm going to be buried. But here's where the money is. And I have to just suck it up and work. And then the chorus is really because I'm not from here, I'm not from there, but here's where I like it, and here's where I'm gonna stay, because I'm not from here, I'm not from there. With two accents in the language, I'm gonna succeed, but here's where I like it, and here's where I'm gonna stay. So I'll play you a little clip of that, about a minute, to get a flavor of it.
¿Qué onda, raza? Aquí les va una rolita que dice la pura neta. Oigan a mi compa Jae-P, échenle, no chillen, cabrones.
Yo no tuve opinión, me trajeron muy morrillo cuando dijo mi papá, vamos cruzando el río. Ni mi cara o mi piel fue la forma aceptada. Made in USA, ching, no valgo nada. Con los años me chingué y me puse bien perrón. Aprendí a hablar inglés, me creía bien chingón. Aunque hablo el idioma, no creas que ya la hice. Para el gringo soy un wetback, un pinche chiste. Ve, vale lo que dice, no piensen en mí. Mijo será presidente de este pinche país. El latino hoy en día no es un simple lavaplato. Hey, Loretta Sanchez, quien te limpie tus zapatos. Si no te aprovechas de esta tierra lo que ofrece, te vas a regresar como un perro que no agradece. México, yo te quiero y allá me enterarán. Pero aquí está la lana y me la tengo que chingar.
Porque no soy de aquí, ni soy de allá.
Pero aquí es donde me gusta y me voy a quedar.
Porque no soy de aquí, ni soy de allá.
Con dos acentos en la lengua llegaré a triunfar.
Porque no soy de aquí, ni soy de allá.
Pero aquí es donde me gusta y me voy a quedar.
Porque no soy de aquí, ni soy de allá.
Te guste o no te guste, a mí me van a aceptar.
So. Okay. So when we turn from that video and thinking about the themes that are raised in the video and the choice of Spanish, mind you, these are bilinguals. They could be rapping in English if they wanted to, and these many of them started out rapping in English but switched to rapping in Spanish, that there's been a conscious choice about language in these videos. And what's interesting here is then what happens in the comment space, which is, of course, dominated by Spanish comments. But then you have here and there some people that are interested in, who don't understand Spanish and who are curious about it, obviously. We have this guy, Del M, who says, can someone please translate the song for me or tell me a website where I can translate the song? So, you know, kind of an earnest interest in what the content of the song is. But then you have someone who's actually policing this as a Spanish space, Kika, who says, how about you learn some Spanish and then you can translate it yourself. Mexicana para toda la vida, sur 13, all the way. So she's saying, this is a Spanish space. Why don't you engage in the linguistic labor instead of always making Spanish speakers do this? You, English speaker, why don't you try to figure out how to speak some Spanish? Why don't you learn some Spanish? And we can see this marked in a kind of non-standard orthography she's written about, not about, but about. How about you learn some Spanish? So a clipped form that has a little bit of a menace to it, perhaps. And then you can translate, see the scare quotes around translate, indicating that this is a kind of labor that, you know, Spanish speakers are always expected to do, but why don't you engage in this? This is your burden. Why don't you figure out how to do it? And then this proud explanation of this proud expression of being Mexicana para toda la vida. So I'm Mexican, you know, for my whole life here. And then we have perhaps a gang identifier, Sur 13, so the Sur South 13. So there are these two iconic gang identities in Los Angeles. There's the South 13s, and then there's the North, the Norteños, which use the number 14, and one of them's red, one of them's blue. They have all kind of this iconography going along with that. But we hear multiple voices in this. So she's using English, she's obviously bilingual, but identifies very strongly as Mexican, and is switching between the two languages, but then also having this non-standard form bout, and then also in the last line, all the way, which is sort of a hip-hop form, if you will. So invoking a hip-hop affiliation, a kind of toughness that you can take on through the voice of hip-hop. So the next example that I have is really about countering origin stories. So the comment mirrors some of the dominant narratives about Mexicans thematized in the video. Here we see DJ who says, mira, güey, se les critica por mamones y racistas, güey. Estos pinches gringos se creen americanos cuando ellos son los wetbacks. Cruzaron todo el pinche Atlántico, güey. Son bien mamones y pendejos. Y hay que chingarnos a los gringos y menos crítica. So he says here, we're reminded of this racist framing of all Mexicans as wetbacks, as if they all entered the United States illegally and they all snuck across the river, rather than what we know about history, which is that the border crossed them and that many, many, many Spanish speakers in the United States were here before the Southwest became part of the United States. We also see this term Americanos highlighted once again with these scare quotes. So this reference is a narrative that probably many people are familiar with here, where, you know, when Americans, I say that in the way that Americans use this term, we call ourselves Americans, we think of ourselves as the only Americans. But when you talk with a lot of Latin Americans, they'll say, you know, you're not the only Americans. We think of ourselves as Americans too. We call ourselves Americanos. You're the Norteamericanos, we're the, you know, the Canadienses could be Americanos, the Mexicanos can be Americanos. So anyway, we don't have exclusive ownership on this term. And these scare quotes are actually highlighting here in explaining, you know, in attacking that, encountering that kind of narrative about who gets to be American. And the third thing we see is He also calls the gringos hypocrites and racist and fools, whereas Mexicans are framed as real Americans with a territorial claim based on seniority of right or right of return. And finally, this idea of who the real wetbacks are. So here we have this idea of Mexicans being wetbacks because they crossed the Rio Grande River, but who are the real wetbacks? Who really have the wetbacks? Well, those are those Europeans who had to actually cross the entire Atlantic Ocean to get to these shores. So it's a kind of compare, you know, trying to set up these contrasts and to counter point by point narratives which discredit Mexicans and take away their right to be here. The previous comment alludes to another theme that surfaces quite frequently in the corpus, that is having to do with the pre-1848 borders between the United States and Mexico. So you may have heard of this Nahuatl term, Aztlan. This is, I'm arguing, a renaming strategy for those who challenge the status of lands ceded to the United States under the terms of the Treaty of Hidalgo. What is now California, New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, Texas, and parts of Wyoming, Colorado, and Oklahoma went from being part of Mexico to the United States. So all the territory that you see in the southwest part that's kind of highlighted or in a lighter shade of gray. So the name Aztlan figures in quite old accounts of pre-Columbian history, but was later taken up by a group of Chicano independence activists during the 1960s and 70s, where Aztlan became a symbol for activists who believe that they have a legal and primordial right to this land. In the poster on the right, from the Movimiento Estudiantil Chicano de Aztlan, the Mecha movement website, you can see the territorial claim and identity claim being made. It asserts that we are Mexicans. We didn't all come to the United States. The United States crossed our borders. So this stands as a foundation for a claim about the linguistic rights of Spanish speakers and of Latinos to be in this country. This map shows what a hypothetical Aztlan would look like, representing where the vast majority of Mexican immigrants reside today and where most of the descendants of Mexicans who became de facto U.S. residents when the border crossed them still live. These kind of representations challenge the myth that people belong on one side of the border or the other and call into question the naturalness of the physical boundaries between those who belong and those who do not. The concept of Aztlan brings to mind Said's notion of imaginative geography as a perception of a space created through certain imagery, texts, and discourses. It's through this imaginary that Jae-P and his fans contest the received versions of American history they're taught in school and assert an alternative version of events that contextualizes their presence within U.S. borders. The term Aztlan invokes a discourse about the rights of Latinos to live in the U.S. and to speak Spanish. Aztlan acts as a resource for rhetorical and ideological action. Invoking Aztlan implicates a set of ideological positions that involve the reclaiming of stolen lands and reuniting them with Mexico. Vihuela's hybrid Spanish Nahuatl expression, Honor Aztlan, and the exhortation, Viva Mexico, invokes what Anzaldúa calls the other imagined Mexico, which connects ancient indigenous people on both sides of a relatively recently established U.S.-Mexican border. So in this comment, Vihuela says, Aztlan, Honor, Viva Mexico, cabrones en todo Canadá y Estados Unidos. Recuperamos nuestra tierra que nos quitaron estos putos. Les hicimos una invasión masiva y nos nadamos estos estados, todo Estados Unidos y llegamos hasta Canadá. Puro Aztlan honor. So in this, he's building on these nationalist sentiments and this idea of an imagined community without borders. He further constructs a Mexican origin audience with collective first-person plural pronouns, such as nuestra, and verb forms such as recuperamos, we will recover. With plentiful swagger, Vihuela represents Mexicans and Mexican-Americans as agentive actors in a historically justified movement to reestablish Aztlan and even extend its boundaries beyond the 48th parallel up to the 49th in Canada. Immigration is reconceived. Immigration across the Rio Grande is reconceived as an empowering act of agency in which the invading, quote unquote, armies of Mexicans are reclaiming their lands. I'll turn next to a few examples of orthographic creativity and nonverbal signaling. These examples come from the corpus, but I'm citing them just to show you a little bit about what this is about. So in the first, esta chida la rola compa. So this is chida is just like cool, I think, in Mexican Spanish, with 54 eyes. So extending, the more eyes you have, the more emphatic this comment becomes, so that it expresses the degree of excitement and enthusiasm. The second one, aquí donde me gusta, aquí me voy a quedar, and here we have the use of K instead of quedar, which normally would be written with a Q and a U, but here you see this employment of K as a kind of countercultural narrative, as a statement about how strongly you feel about this particular stance. Another one says, está chido la rola. And here you have the mixture of upper and lowercase, which kind of looks a little bit like punk rock, but the mixture of upper and lowercase graphemes also has this kind of countercultural stance. And potentially gives you a little bit of a window into the perspective of the writer. And here in the last one, I think Matt's written a little bit about this too. So the choice of particular variants of spelling seem to be not only dialectal, but perhaps also markers of identity. So writing estaba with a V might be, I'm not sure because I don't know, I can't get into the head of the people who write this stuff, but In some cases, people have argued that this might be some kind of marker of local identity. This might be a way that Mexican-American kids write as a way of taking a stance about who they are. And canciones, well, you could argue that's maybe a dialectal form. It's just representing the way that people actually pronounce this form. It's like a pronunciation form. But yeah, it at times it's hard to actually make a decision. In any case, I've looked at a bunch of these forms and I've found some interesting patterns, and I theorized that perhaps there's kind of a markedness scale. That is, there are a whole bunch of forms people use on the internet that might be kind of unmarked. That is, they're so common and typical that nobody thinks they're strange, like writing the letter U or using the grapheme U for the pronoun U. And that goes for, using for in place of a preposition for, using in Spanish, using the grapheme K in place of the complementizer, a relative pronoun K, or using the letter D or the letter T in place of prepositions like they or the clitic de. So those are really common. They're incredibly common, and you see those all over the place, and they probably don't really have a lot of social meaning. But when you get into the more deliberate and conscious choices people are making in terms of spelling, this is where it gets more interesting, because these are choices people are making. It isn't kind of necessarily just unconscious. People are actually probably thinking a little bit more about the selection of graphemes to represent speech. And an example would be not only the use of the grapheme K for like cabrón or something or casa, but also I've seen some examples like the use of S, the grapheme S in place of a syllable. But it relies on the English pronunciation of a syllable, not the Spanish, because the letter S would be ese in Spanish, right? But in English, it's S. But here you have escucha. So writers who are using this, you can only interpret this if you think in English and Spanish. When you're going, okay, it makes sense if you take the English pronunciation of S and go escucha, then it makes sense, right? So these, I think, are more marked choices. That are doing some more semiotic work and signaling something like I'm bilingual, I can play with these two systems. I understand how to use these two systems and you know, be very creative about it. And here you can see some very graphic examples of this in Chica One's narrative. So she says, sé que soy ruca y que se escucha mal. You can see that escucha with just the S. So escucha, it would be escucha, meaning it's hard to hear, right? So se escucha mal. And she's using the letter C in the first, in place of the, I guess, clitic would be a clitic, right? So se escucha. It, one listens to it, right? Pero como me caga el puto palo, gente mamona, ojetes de mierda, que dicen que no les gusta esa música y que de hate cholos. So you can see she's mixing English and Spanish. She's mixing English and Spanish graphemes and relying on pronunciations of English in order to make sense out of the words in front of you. And lots of shorthand, a lot of variation in the kinds of things she's doing. But the overall effect is a rather marked and angry and strident voice that's, you know, responding to the people that don't like this video. She's saying, you know, I know I'm a gang girl and it's hard to hear, but I can't stand these dumbass pieces of shit who say they don't like this music and then they hate cholos and what bullshit, but they have to come over here, sons of slutty, dirty mother, and listen to this. Who the fuck asked them? Why don't they go fuck their mother? So anyway, she's not really going on about any kind of, you know, larger narratives other than just to be angry, but this is an illustration of how these graphemes get put into service, if you will. And my last example, the title of the talk, is, I think, a really beautiful example of heteroglossic writing, in that it's indexing not only the author's bilingual competence and awareness of how English speakers render Spanish phonemes, but other culturally situated social meanings. These polyphonous graphemic representations in the example reflect the author's knowledge of English spelling, while simultaneously voicing a generalized sentiment about white Americans. So in this example, what you have is the voice of a gringo, of a white person speaking Spanish. And how do you render that in ordinary orthography? Well, you take English lexemes, like pink and chess and gring and gous, to indicate the way that Americans pronounce Spanish when they don't really have a very good accent, right? So pink, we have the lax variant of the vowel, not pink, but pink. And chess, this is a very, very clever way of signaling the way that Americans pronounce, the fact that Americans can't render these vowels the way that Spanish speakers do. It's telling us how we're to hear the vowels. It's an auditory experience, signaling how we're to interpret this message. So it's not only voicing this English speaker, but it's critiquing this English speaker, saying like, these fucking, it's not only the content of the actual phrase, but it's like layers and layers of critique written into this single form, right? It's mocking the English pronunciation of the gringos, and it's also complaining about the gringos at the same time. So these fucking gringos, pinches gringos. Now this, once again, this is kind of a meme. If you start looking up pinches gringos, you'll find all kinds of stuff on the internet about people making little videos about how funny it is to say fucking gringo, pinches gringos. And so it's a bit of a meme. It's not like this is just some guy who came up with this funny statement. This is something, it's almost like a refrain that Mexicans will tap into and instantly kind of put their mind in this particular frame of, oh, the fucking gringos, they're always doing this stuff, right? They're always making our lives difficult. It's always a pain in the ass. And here's just one more example of this. But what I really love about that is just how creative it is in rendering this, doing this multiple kinds of voicing. All right, so to wrap up now, I've shown you some of the hybrid, multi-voice, discursive, and orthographic practices that bilingual Mexican-American youth use to signal their alignments, stances, and identities on YouTube. Through language choices and discursive references to Mexico's pre-1848 borders, young Mexican-Americans stake out stances of resistance towards hegemonic English. and express nationalist and anti-colonialist sentiments. Posting comments in Spanish is an act of counter-hegemonic resistance and a challenge to the dominance and hegemonic status of English as the language of power, education, and the internet. Commenting in Spanish or rapping in Spanish can also be interpreted as a way to keep it real in the hip-hop sense by opting to express oneself in a socially marked and stigmatized minority language, but one that for young Latinos also indexes something essential and elemental about their identities. The comments shown here illustrate how Latino youth contest their marginalized status, not only by choosing to express themselves in Spanish, but also through the emphatic assertion of ethnic and local and translocal identities. So as Doymet writes, rather than arbitrarily mixing linguistic forms, and highly crafted, these very highly crafted utterances combine forms for maximum effect, allowing writers to articulate different voices and create artful tensions and semantic conflicts which reflect the writer's entire linguistic repertoire. Thank you very much.
Thanks, that was really interesting. I was just wondering if you noticed, all you have are names with which you assign sex. I was wondering if you noticed any difference in the nature of the content between males and females.
I didn't specifically look at that. You know, there's so many comments that are just kind of throwaway comments. A lot of them are just kind of like, oh, I love this song, or oh, this is great, or oh, this reminds me of some movie, because I think the song was actually featured in a film called Fight Club or something like that. So there's a lot of references to that. So I'm not sure how many would actually surface and whether one could do an analysis of it, but that's a good question.
Well, especially the ones that are stronger statements of, you know, assertions of Mexican identity and rejection of the dominant narrative.
Yeah, there is quite a bit of putative gang involvement. So a lot of people that are marking their identities as being either from the South 13s or the North 14s, and that girl in particular seems to claim that kind of identity. So I wonder if it tends to be a kind of particular kind of girl who would, or female figure who would post such a comment, you know, and the extent to which, I mean, since rap is such a male dominated or seemingly male dominated musical form, whether, you know, the extent to which young women are actually participating in these kinds of discourses. Yeah, thanks.
Hi, that was really interesting. I was thinking about something you said towards the beginning, reflecting on my family's story, because it made me want to ask my father something. My grandfather is no longer alive. He would be second generation. Mm. And it was interesting that you cite how they're feeling neither fish nor fowl. They're neither here nor there. And yet that is, in a way, a privilege of the time in which they're living. Mm. Because when my grandfather would have been alive and maybe feeling some of these things, would have been the early 1900s. And at that time, the pressure to be American and to assimilate completely and to negate where you come from was so powerful. Mm-hmm. The nationalistic tendencies and everything in this country were so, those forces were so strong. Mm-hmm. And the forces against immigrants and the oppression was so even more explicit in some ways, that it made me wonder about that with respect to some of these, not just the postings, but the rap and everything else. Is there ever a discussion of that? You know, sort of that historical. You know, that there's a. I don't know. I'm not sure if I've got a question in there or not. There's something slightly ahistorical and about it, but.
Well, for me, it raises the question of what it's like to be an immigrant nowadays who is not from Europe, because I think there must be a huge difference between, you know, the waves of immigration, to borrow a metaphor, that happened in the 19th century, late 19th century, early 20th century, mainly from Southern Europe and Eastern Europe, people coming from the pogroms in Russia and Ukraine and Poland, and people coming from Italy and like. And so they're obviously, you know, they must have experienced quite a bit of discrimination and perhaps racism as well. But at the same time, they were coming from European shores and were perceived to be, at least some of them were perceived to be European. Whereas I think with these young people, there's a strong sense that they are brown, that they are people of color, and that it doesn't matter what they do, they're still not accepted. And that is obviously a very strong theme for them, that even though you work really hard, even though you learn English, even though you don't have an accent, even though you're born here, that you're still not accepted as being American. You're still marked by your skin color and your face in ways that immigrants from other places are not. So, but I think there are probably other dimensions of this that that one could get into, but that's what comes to mind initially. Thank you.
I have a question, if you don't mind. Just in terms, having listened to the song before, one of his verses talks about how he's also doesn't feel accepted in Mexico, so neither accepted in the United States nor in Mexico.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering, it's neither fish nor fowl, as was heard. Just wondering about whether anything in the commentary gave an idea of a separate identity coming into play, or what would the commentary saying about, I think it's been described as sureño maybe, or this kind of border identity. Mm-hmm. Was there anything in the commentary that you saw that might have spoken to that?
I mean, not explicit references, but I mean, really, as a collective, looking at this entire corpus, you can say that many of the young people contributing to this have the same kind of feeling, so that, you know, effectively they are kind of this is kind of an identity, the identity of not being from here or from there, the intermediate identity. And so many of them make that same kind of comment. They say, oh, this song is me. This is who I am. This is my experience. This is what I've experienced. And this is my song, and that kind of thing. So you get a lot of that. I mean, but there is no articulation of a third identity, then, of this intermediate identity. It's just sort of the acknowledgement that this is how a lot of people feel. Yeah.
Thanks for the talk. That was fantastic. The one example that I keep thinking about is the one, the longer one, where there were so many sort of orthographic deviations from the standard orthography, right? And it gets me thinking. I like your scale of orthographic markedness, where the one side is conscious, deliberate, and more socially meaningful or more marked, right? Mm-hmm. And it got me thinking about, and this is something I've been thinking about a lot lately, is the use of language not as a communicative tool for the meaning so much of the words as almost, that one in particular made me think of like a graphic argot sort of thing, mm-hmm. You know, something like back in the 90s, like leet speak, you know, where it's not meant to be read easily by people outside of a certain very inscribed circle, right? Mm-hmm. And that to me connects to the Latino threat narrative you were talking about, Carter's work, and the idea that display of graphic threat is powerful in itself, mm-hmm. right? It's a form of power, it's a form of capital. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's really, really something cool there. So, yeah.
Thank you for that comment. Yeah, very, very interesting. I think there is something really visual about that example. And I pull it up really quickly, but that is, it takes effort to read it at first, and you're struck by the number, like you say, the number of deviations that, you know, and what that social meaning is could be teased out certainly a bit more, but it seems to be it's a very strong message. It's an angry, quite strident claim of difference.
Zero accommodation.
Yeah. So rejection of standard language norms and everything that goes along with that, schooling, official schooling, behaving properly, conforming to white normative cultural patterns and expected behaviors. And so this language becomes a semiotic way of signaling nonconformity. And it's a very strong one. It's not just the occasional grapheme. It's sort of every word almost in the entire utterance. Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah.
Does Jae-P rap in English as well on his other songs, or does he code switch?
I haven't listened to everything he's ever done, but apparently he started out rapping in English, and then he switched to Spanish. And mostly he seems to rap in Spanish, but he has some songs. You can find songs that are in English.
It would be interesting to see if the medium of the lyrics predicted the proportion of, you know, code choice in the comments.
Yeah, it seems to. I mean, just superficially from what I've seen, yes, absolutely. So videos in Spanish will have much more commentary in Spanish.
Yeah.
And videos in English will have much more commentary. Will be dominated by English.
Yeah. I'm most interested, I think, to see, like, if mixing is predicted. Like, if there's more code switching in the song, would there be more mixed comments as well? Because it would, I mean, it's kind of stands to reason that, like, Spanish speakers would be more likely to engage with Spanish lyrics because they can.
Yeah.
And the same with English. But if you have to be bilingual to really get the full meaning of the song, then you have the full choice of codes in your comments. And do you still choose to sort of mirror the form of the lyrics?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think this is a particularly salient case because the video is making such a strong claim about the rights of Spanish speakers and Latinos and Mexican Americans, and therefore maybe there is more mirroring of that in the choice of languages and the language in the lyrics. I was surprised that there wasn't more mixing. I thought this is a group of bilinguals; they're all going to be mixing all the time. But you know, and this example has some mixing, obviously, but you know, the vast majority of the comments don't. You know, there seems to be this conscious choice to use. I don't know. I'm just, my claim is, and I'm struck by it because I think it does seem marked for them just to use Spanish. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it seems like a stance to me of a choice, a kind of a statement,
right?
That Spanish is, that this will be a Spanish space, and we will enforce this this language of this particular space. Thanks.
Hey, thank you for the talk. I was thinking about the term American. Once I was in Africa, in Sudan, and somebody asked me, where are you from? And I said, well, I'm from Peru. So he said, Peru, where? Where is it? Where is it? And then he said, are you American? And I said, well, you're right, I'm American.
Yeah.
You know? And I had to explain him, you know, where was Peru, and America is a continent, so America is not United States, and that thing. And then when you talk about that, I started to think about, because in Spanish, when I try to refer to an American, I said estadounidense. I always use that term, because for me, estadounidenses are from Estados Unidos,
right?
You know?
Yeah. Right, like Mexicans or Peruvians would never call Americans, like here, Americanos, they would call them estadounidenses.
I mean, sometimes, but the most of the time we use the term estadounidenses, norteamericanos, but norteamericanos are Mexicans and Canadians as well.
That's true. That's
you
true.
Know?
Yeah.
And just few of us use the term of Americans,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But I was thinking about how this term impact in like second generation immigrants who live here and they don't have a kind of a clarity or national identity, you know, very, very clear. And they want to become Americans, to be Americans, but at the same time they think, but I'm American. So how that does it affect, you know, that kind of identity?
Well, from these minimal examples I have, it just seems like they are recognizing this problematic, if you will. They are referencing this as, you know, who is Americano? They're asking this question, and they're challenging the idea that it's just people from the United States, estadounidenses, who call themselves American. Why is that? And they're questioning who they are, but they're not. It's more about a larger narrative, I think, they're accessing. They're talking about this discourse of who is American, without necessarily going into the level of what they are, how they identify themselves. I think they're not. That wasn't exactly part of that particular example, but you know, it's an interesting question. I've often thought about how other people outside the United States call Americans. So what, I mean, I'm using the term because that's what we use here, but like in Germany, we're called die Amis, right? The American, die Americana, right? I mean, in many, many countries, we're called the Americans, but it's only problematic in terms of Latin America, where other people use that term as well. So I'm not sure, you know, it's a very interesting local narrative, it's like a dialectic between particularly Mexicans and Latin Americans and estadounidenses about who gets to use that term. But yeah, thanks for bringing that up.
I don't know if I have a good question or not. I enjoyed your talk because I came here because I'm like first generation Korean immigrant family. And so like, I totally understand like the push and the pull, and they may be brown, but like, obviously like I look different too. So like, it's definitely different than being like from Europe or something. But I think like Asian Americans, like they study hard and then they get into their fields. Like, I'm wondering like what kind of population or demographic is actually listening to this rap music that they feel like they can't like join the, I don't know, upper society or something, or a higher, you know, I mean, that's my question, I guess.
So you're really talking about different immigrant groups that come here with and end up having different kinds of life trajectories. And it's an eternal question, but I mean the work that I'm familiar with is very much rooted in where people are coming from and the kinds of resources that they come with. So I think in the case of a lot of immigrants from Mexico, it has to do with the fact that people are literally coming here with second grade education, with, you know, virtually no job skills and no money, and have to start at a much lower point in the social hierarchy in terms of working their way up, getting a leg up in society. My understanding is that a lot of immigrants from Korea and from Japan or from various places come with a much higher level of education and more monetary resources, so that, you know, where people are coming in, they, you know, you rise up from the position you come in at and the resources you can foster. And so I think that explains quite a bit of the issue. You know, if you're talking about middle class immigrants from Mexico, I'm sure that they have similar trajectories to a lot of other, you know, a lot of immigrants from Korea, for example. But yeah, sure.
Okay, so thank you very much, Dr. Cutler, again.
Thank you.
Wonderful speech. Thank you all for coming. We hope to have some more social justice and language talks in April, so please check your feeds. We will be hopefully putting those on in April. More information will be coming out soon. Thank you all for coming tonight.